Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome to Administrative Static. This is John Vecchione, to be joined by Mark Chenoweth. And I want to first apologize for last week's radio show. We seem to have a technical glitch. Perhaps the Western UFOs knocked out our taping, but we had taped a show and three segments did not get picked up on the tape for some reason. So I apologize to anyone who was listening and wondered what happened. Anyway. I am going to start off today's broadcast with a disturbing case out of the Ninth Circuit. And this case is Verdun v. the City of San Diego, October 26, 2022. And it's an opinion by Judge Brass, and it has a dissent by Judge Bumatai. And this case is about chalking your tires. And whether or not that's Fourth Amendment search and whether if it is a search under the Fourth Amendment to the United States Constitution, whether or not it's requires a warrant. So the court of the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, and that's important, we'll come back to that, has found that the practice of law enforcement of going around and putting chalk marks on your tires when you park somewhere so that they can tell where you've been there more than 2 hours or whatever the time limit is on the publicly owned parking spaces, that they can then tell. And under the Sixth Circuit has an opinion already that says, no, that's a search. They search your they search and they require a warrant. It's a trespassory search. They're actually invading your property. They're putting chalk on your car. What has gone on here is that the Sixth Circuit found very clearly that this was a search and that it was warrantless and that you needed a warrant because you can't just go around assuming people have been breaking the law. And what happened here? Well, the Ninth Circuit came out the other way, 2-1. They say, and here's their story. Their story is that this type of search of parking spaces started sometime in the 1930s. And they cite a bunch of cases from all over the country where people used to chalk the tires of cars, even in the early days of the automobile, for this very purpose. But nobody that the Ninth Circuit says, thought that this was any kind of Fourth Amendment violation until the Jones case, where the Supreme Court noted that there's two types of analysis they'll do in searches. One is the trespassory, one is the invasion of privacy. It's whether you have a privacy interest, and that is cases like cats where they tape your phone calls and things of that nature. But the Supreme Court revived the trespassory nature of a search, meaning, you know, like when the British officials would come into your house and toss the place, or when the police do that in the old procedurals. So that is a trespassory search because they come on your property. So here, the trespass is putting chalk on your car. Now, what does the Ninth Circuit say about that? Well, they say, yeah, we assume it's a search, but we're going to go through and say it's an administrative search. Now, this doctrine is not one I'm too thrilled with. But what it means is that there are certain types of searches for administrative purposes that are not for law enforcement purposes that are allowed as long as they're reasonable and not too invasive and you know, it doesn't really cause a problem. And that was usually under the expectation of privacy prong of the search requirements. But they have now, the Ninth Circuit has now moved this to Jones type searches, which are trespassory. And I think that's going to be a problem for them. So what else do they say? Well, they say, it's de minimis, a little chalk on your tire. That's not causing you a lot of problems. Although, I don't know if any of you folks out there have ever met some of these car fanatics. If you put chalk on any part of their vehicle, they would go ballistic. But apparently the Ninth Circuit says, well, first of all, is this important? And they go on to, in rapturous praise of everything that car chalking can do. Why do we need these parking spaces? Well, if we don't have these parking spaces, people will have to cruise. They call it cruise around, and sometimes maybe they'll park in the handicapped spots. And so this chalking, it helps commerce, it helps traffic flow. It's a wondrous device. And really, they go on for pages with how important this all is. And then they go on for pages on how hard the other methods of finding out if you've been there too long are. And they say, well, you know, there's all these police requirements and all this sort of thing. So I was a little bit amused at how it looked, but in any event, so the first thing is the parking spaces are too hard to monitor in any other way, according to them, and then also it's so de minimis. They're just putting chalk on your car. They're just putting it on your tire. Well, the Fifth Circuit has ruled that a trespassory search is just pressing your finger into a tire to see whether or not there's contraband stored in the tire. So I think that what the Ninth Circuit has done here, so they go through the analysis. They say, oh, look, this is, and they cite this case Patel. And in Patel, there was a hotel that was being searched. I'll just put it that way. I won't go into the full facts of it, but the key thing is it was out of the Ninth Circuit. And the Ninth Circuit found that these type of searches of hotels were okay because they're a highly regulated industry, the hotel industry. And the Supreme Court took the case and reversed them so fast your head would spin. And they said, no, this is not heavily regulated industry. That exception is very narrow, because what the Supreme Court has said is if it's the sort of industry, and they've only had three, like one of them is making explosives, right? I always use the example of nuclear power, because from the minute it started, the U.S. government invented it. So you got to assume it's highly regulated, and it can obviously, a leak would be a big problem. So it's dangerous. It's both heavily regulated and dangerous. And I think that's the test now under Patel. So the Ninth Circuit keeps citing Patel, not taking any notice that Patel, it was only there because the Ninth Circuit got struck down and reversed. So this case goes on, and not only do they have pans of rapture over how getting everyone out of the parking spaces quickly improves the lives of everyone in the Ninth Circuit, but they also say that this is very de minimis and it doesn't really cause any problem. And then they take a shot at the dissent, which is Judge Bumatai, and he says, wait a minute, this is just like what the British were doing. And so here's what the majority says about that. I kind of liked it. Nor can tire chalking be made to violate the Constitution through hyperbole. The dissent offers no support for its grandiose suggestion that the benign practice of lightly dusting chalk on the tire of a car parked in a city space is comparable to the Crown officials' abuse of investigative tools that helped spark the American Revolution. And the dissent's apparent contention that tire chalking, quote, exhibits the same characteristics as general warrants and writs is obviously inaccurate. The general warrants of the colonial era allowed royal officials to search and seize whatever and whomever they pleased while investigating crimes or affronts to the crown, with officers, quote, rummaging through homes in unrestrained search for evidence of criminal activity. Tire chalking is, of course, not that. So, this is the part I really like, because I think this may be true, and I don't think it helps them. Much of the dissenting opinion appears grounded in the belief that the entire administrative search doctrine is an affront to the original meaning of the Fourth Amendment and should therefore be extremely limited in its application. And yes, Mark has joined us. Yes, yes, that's exactly right. I think they've got the, I think they've got it. By George, they've got it.
You can almost see the light bulb going off.
You say, then they say the Supreme Court has never said this. And they say the dissent's high level historical overview certainly does not prove it either. And so, and the same can be said of the dissent's repeated reliance on a dissenting opinion from Justice O'Connor in Veronia, which of course is not the law, which I will add is not the law yet, because now what has happened? So I'll just talk about.
Can I say one thing about that, John?
Yeah, yeah.
Which is, so where does the majority draw the line? Essentially what they're saying is, if it's not too bad, it doesn't violate. But the dissent draws a clear line there. If there's a physical trespass, that is a search. That's very easy for judges to administrate. It doesn't matter whether the physical trespass is an inch or a mile. It's a line that you can draw and you can police.
And what happened here also is they kind of diss the Jones opinion that found the physical trespass. Their very first thing is, no one ever thought of this before Jones. And this is a point which I can see being made, which is that this thing has happened since time immemorial, this chalking business. And so they say that just because Jones came along, we're very reluctant to overturn it. That's a reasonable thing that it's gone on for 75 years. But if the Supreme Court tells you that a physical invasion of any kind is a Jones search, then you have to take that seriously. And they just brush it off. And then they sort of brush off Patel where they got reversed.
Like so much chalk.
Right. And and it's not like a liberal conservative. There's Trump appointees on either side of this.
I mean, it's not just the physical trespass. I mean, that's definitely a line you can police. But it's also the fact that there's completely innocent conduct here.
Correct.
And if you allow searches of completely innocent conduct, then where do you draw the line? Can you search? We have the case against the IRS for Mr. Harper. Can you search his records for, whether or not whether or not he's paid his taxes when there's no evidence that he hasn't?
You're absolutely right. So Judge Bumatai, I didn't get a chance to go through his dissent, but it was blistering, as you can tell from what the majority said about it. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Administrative Static. Wanted to share with you an amicus brief that the New Civil Liberties Alliance filed this week in the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit. This is in the case of Greenberg v. Lehocky. And John, we're in this case is up from the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Pennsylvania. And we're in the somewhat unusual position in this case of supporting someone who won below. So that's nice to see. Occasionally we have the opportunity to do that. The Third Circuit has been known to overturn cases from below before. So we're not out of the woods yet. But what this case involves is a rule, and it's Rule 8.4G, that the Pennsylvania bar has tried to pass and foment on lawyers who are licensed in Pennsylvania. And the problem with what they're doing, and I know we've talked about this before in the Connecticut context, John, because we have this case called Cerami v. Bowler, where NCLA is, we're actually the lawyers suing over that.
Certain pressure groups are trying to get this 8.4G in every state. I think we'll see it everywhere unless we do something.
Yeah, so if you're listening and you're not in Pennsylvania or Connecticut, you are not out of the woods. This is an orchestrated campaign to get this rule passed in many, many jurisdictions across the country. So let us tell you about it and be on the alert for it in Colorado or wherever you are, because it may be coming your way next. But the problem with Rule 8.4G is that it tries to regulate attorney speech, not just attorney speech in the courtroom or in briefs, but even attorney speech in conversations with clients, attorney speech in the uh, in uh, bar association meetings, in CLEs, just anywhere where a lawyer is acting in their professional capacity, essentially, this rule purports to cover them. And it's almost as though the Pennsylvania Bar Association doesn't know about the First Amendment. It's a little shocking. But the problem with the rule is that it is both it's a viewpoint based kind of discrimination, meaning that it applies if you are engaged in speech that's denigrating to about 11 different categories of people. But it doesn't apply if you're saying things praiseworthy toward those groups of people. Well, that is textbook viewpoint discrimination, which the First Amendment forbids. It's also content discriminatory, which the First Amendment forbids, because, as I say, it applies to these 11 different categories of conduct. Not conduct. What the rule says is that you can't say things that are denigrating to folks based on their race, sex. These are the 11 speech topics: race, sex, gender identity or expression, religion, national origin, ethnicity, disability, age, sexual orientation, marital status, and socioeconomic status. So those are the 11 forbidden categories. It's almost as though they went back to the 1980s and took all the punchlines of all the jokes from the 1980s and said, okay, those are all off the table.
Even George Carlin only had 7 words you couldn't say on the radio.
That's right. They've upped it to 11 categories of harassing or discriminatory speech. And so this under Rule 8.4G, this kind of speech would be considered misconduct, and it would subject you to discipline from the bar, and presumably it could cause your license to be suspended or revoked if you engaged in speech that was sufficiently problematic from the bar association's point of view. Well, we have jumped into this case to say a couple of things. First of all, we have tried to buttress Mr. Greenberg's standing in the case. The other side here has attacked his standing and suggests that there's no real chance that that he is going to be subjected to any discipline under this rule. And so the defendant appellant here is Jeremy Lehocky in his official capacity as the board chair of the disciplinary board of the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania. The plaintiff appellee is Zachary Greenberg. And as I say, the case is in the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit. It's case number 22-1733, if you're interested in looking it up. And our colleague Rich Samp is the author of the amicus brief for NCLA. So props to Rich for his usual sterling job on this amicus brief. But let me jump back into what I was saying about standing, which is they're trying to suggest that simply because they don't think that the kinds of things that he has said would subject him to discipline, that he doesn't have a standing to object to the rule. But standing is a little bit broader in the First Amendment context than it is in other contexts for a couple of different reasons. First of all, there's this concern about chilling speech. And so the courts have tended to recognize that it's not just the fact that you would be penalized. It's the fact that you might have an actual and well-founded fear that you could be the target of an enforcement action, and that actual and well-founded fear is sufficient to create standing because an actual and well-founded fear is sufficient to chill your speech. So what Mr. Greenberg talks about is the fact that he has given CLE presentations before where people have come up to him after his CLE presentation and have said that they were offended by what he said. Well, if this new rule were in place and someone were offended by what he said and what he said was along these lines, then presumably that person could file a bar complaint and he might face, discipline.
And Mark, I don't know that 30 years ago we would have flagged this so quickly, But what has happened with Judge, what has happened in the law schools and who's coming out of law schools and what they say is offensive or somehow discriminatory has so metastasized that who can tell?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And one of the examples that Rich gives in here is one you're very familiar with, John, which is what happened to Professor Ilya Shapiro at Georgetown, where he he had an unfortunate tweet that wasn't worded very well, but where he was essentially objecting to President Biden's the fact that he was only considering African-American female candidates for a vacancy on the Supreme Court. I think that it's fair to say that what he said would have come within the confines of Rule 8.4G if he was subject to that. And Rich's point here is that he analogized it. Well, he talks about what happened to Professor Shapiro in the amicus brief and suggests that it would be inappropriate to discipline a lawyer for engaging in this kind of speech or chilling this kind of speech the way that Georgetown Law School decided to chill this kind of speech. It's just not where we need to be going. We need to be having the ability to. The law is all about finding the truth based on the clash of views, and you need to preserve that clash of views, even speech that's offensive, and you need to correct that offensive speech with more and better speech, not with censorship or with prohibiting or punishing the speech that you find offensive. So as I say, there's a relaxed injury, in fact, a standard for asserting free speech claims. Mr. Greenberg has adequately demonstrated his actual and well-founded fear based on his CLE conduct, CLE presentations in the past. And then the last thing on this is that the evidentiary burden to establish injury in fact, is particularly relaxed with respect to the overbreadth claim in this case. Under the overbreadth doctrine of the First Amendment, someone is able to facially challenge a rule that is overly broad, even if there are elements of the rule that or ways in which the rule could be constitutionally. Maybe that's not the best way to say that. Even though there are applications of the rule that might not run afoul of the First Amendment, that doesn't save the rule. If the rule is overbroad, then the fact that you would be subject to the rule allows you to object to the overbreadth of the rule, even though you aren't currently being subjected to one of those overbroad enforcement applications. And that doctrine has been in place for a long time. And I think that combination of factors assures that Mr. Greenberg's standing is solid here and it won't be kicked out on that basis by the Third Circuit. The other thing that we point out, John, that Rich points out in this amicus brief for NCLA, is that Rule 8.4G is really invalid in all of its applications. And the reason that it's invalid in all of its applications is because it's a viewpoint-based speech restriction. And it's just a really black-letter constitutional law that viewpoint-based speech restrictions are invalid. And we walked through what that viewpoint basis is. Essentially, you can't say denigrating things. You can say positive things. And the other thing that Rich points out in this brief is something that happened to one of our clients in Connecticut, where he was essentially involved in a heated conversation at a bar related event, and the conversation was the client is a white male attorney. The heated conversation was with an African American woman. And she was speaking in favor of racial justice measures in the wake of George Floyd's murder. And the other attorney responded by calling her a quote unquote race pandering nitwit who was quote unquote suffering from black entitlement. And that attorney testified in Connecticut that the other attorneys in support of Rule 8.4G up there, that the other attorney's speech constituted improper racial discrimination and that this conduct should never be okay. And this testimony demonstrates the sort of speech that sponsors of Rule 8.4G are targeting for sanction, and we wanted to bring that to the attention of the Third Circuit as well. So we'll keep an eye on this. We'll let you know what the Third Circuit decides to do. Hopefully the First Amendment will still be safe in Pennsylvania and safe for lawyers there. Stay tuned for more right after this.